Good afternoon. Welcome to the Cathedral of Little Angel. My name is Father Antonio Cachaport. I'm the pastor here at the Cathedral. It's a privilege and honor to have you today as we celebrate the life of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And his dream will continue to live today and always. We pray that we may continue to build the kingdom of God on this earth, which is the kingdom of love, justice, and peace. God bless you and your family, far and near. Thank you for joining us today.
This is my story. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
So we gather this afternoon to celebrate the life and work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. It is a special grace to welcome all of you, and especially the Knights and Ladies of Superior Claver. Today, we, as we usually do, we celebrate the body of Mass for the preservation of peace and justice. It is a moment to give thanks to God for the life and example of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and continue his ministry among us. So let's start our celebration acknowledging our sins and preparing ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess
to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have great sin in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do.
Through my fault, through my most grievous faults.
Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever-Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, who have revealed that peacemakers are to be called your children, grant, we pray, that we may work without ceasing to establish that justice which alone ensures true and lasting peace. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me. He has sent me to bring glad tidings to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and release to the prisoners, and to announce a year of favor from the Lord and a day of vindication by our God. I rejoice heartily in the Lord. In my God is the joy of my soul, for he has clothed me with a robe of salvation and wrapped me in a mantle of justice. Like a bridegroom adorned with a diadem, like a bride bedecked with her jewels, as the earth brings forth its plants, and the Lord God make justice and praise spring up before all the nations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm today is taken from Psalm 110. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. The scepter of your power the Lord will stretch forth from Zion, rule in the midst of your enemies. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. Yours is princely power in the day of your birth, in holy splendor. Before the day star like the dew, I have begotten you. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. The Lord has sworn and he will not repent. You are a priest forever according to the order of Melchizedek. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek. You are a priest forever in the line of Melchizedek.
A reading from the letter of the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, every high priest is taken from among men and made there respectively before God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal patiently with the ignorant and the errant, for he himself is beset by weakness. And so, for this reason, must take sin offerings for himself as well as for the people. No one takes this honor upon himself, but only when God calls him, as Aaron was. In the same way, it was not Christ who glorified himself by becoming high priest, but rather the one who said to him, "You are my son. This day I have begotten you." Just as he says in the other place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Discern reflections and thoughts of the heart. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
From the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The disciples of John and of the Pharisees were accustomed to fast. People came to Jesus and objected, "Why do the disciples of John and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast?" Jesus answered them, "Can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and then they will fast on that day. No one sews a piece of unshrunken cloth on an old cloth. If he does, its fullness pulls away the new from the old, and the tear gets worse. Likewise, no one pours new wine into old wineskins. Otherwise, the wine will burst the skins, and both the wine and the skins are ruined. Rather, new wine is poured into fresh wineskins.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia. 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 Alleluia.
Beloved in Christ, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm very grateful, and I ask you to thank God with me for this invitation to break open God's Word and to reflect upon the life of Dr. King today. Especially grateful, too, for the Knights and Ladies Auxiliary of St. Peter Claver, especially the coordinating courts and councils, as well as for the African American Center for Evangelization. Thank you, too, Archbishop, for your blessing and permission to preach here. When I received the call from Greg Warner, I immediately started to think about past homilies and sermons that I've heard about Dr. King. And for the 6 years that I lived in Costa Mesa, in the Diocese of Orange, I had the good fortune to live with one of our now retired confreres and priests, Father Robert. And in my community, I think Father Robert is probably maybe one of two or three others only who spent a significant amount of time working in the African American community. And it just so happened that during those 6 years, he was always assigned to preach on Mondays. And so every year, when we would celebrate MLK, he would preach on that day. And before I could let Greg know that, I learned that I was being given very specific directives about the theme and angle for this reflection, that we would consider the thought and the spirituality of Dr. King in terms of his teaching about the beloved community, which is in the first place for us, we would say, God's own community, his people, the people he has purchased with his own blood. Now, it's true, though, that Dr. King was very, very scholarly, okay? He's a Morehouse man. And that exposure to the academic realm gave him also the perspective of Josiah Royce, who's a California philosopher. And he really developed here, even in our own West Coast, this idea of the necessity of belonging to a community of love. In so many words, he said that really to exist without existing in love is not to exist at all. And so that is an aspect of Dr. King's teaching. But it's not the only one. It's not really even the most important one, I think. Because besides being an academic, he was a scholar. Besides being in his own right and truly a politician, besides being an activist, besides being a pastor, Dr. King saw himself as a disciple of Christ, a disciple of Christ. And I think most of us know, I know at least the Transfiguration faithful, know that to be a disciple means to be a student. To be a disciple means to be a student. And so Dr. King has this approach of being in a beloved community, not because he ever, I don't think, saw himself as even the perfect role model, even though he was a good role model. But what he saw himself was as a disciple of Christ. And as a disciple of Christ, he was in a position, in a very privileged position, to speak about being in a beloved community. Now, we heard in this gospel passage from St. Mark about new wine and old, and new wine and old wineskins. And one of the things that often comes up in our conversations about Dr. King is that there are certain differences in emphasis from his early days of preaching to his latter days of preaching. And there's good evidence for that, that even Dr. King himself had some new thoughts, changed thoughts from things he maybe focused on early on. I have a theory, and I think it's backed up by the gospel passage that we just heard, at least a countertext, that even as Dr. King became more actively involved, even in political realms, the foundation of his action and his activity was always the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I say that because we heard from St. Mark about this new wine. But when St. Luke recounts the very same episode when there was this discussion about fasting, our Savior and teacher ends it all and he says, who prefers new wine to old? Who prefers new wine to old? Which is to say, if we have good wine, the old is better. And so he was giving us this indication to go back to the foundation. And again, I think that is what we can take with us as we consider this teaching of Dr. King in terms of the beloved community. That insofar as we cover the beloved community under any other aspect, as important and essential as they might be, we go back to that foundation, which is the gospel, that we have a God who proved his love for us in that while we were still his enemies, he came, was born for us of a virgin mother, and he died for us that we might live. We don't rush to this, ignoring the real injustices that have been suffered by people throughout all ages, but especially for those of us here who are, many of us, descendants of enslaved persons in the United States. We recognize that the injustices which were inflicted on so many of our ancestors are very real and not to be ignored. Sometimes in current conversations, there is an objection raised that many of our ancestors themselves did not take such offense at what happened to them as people today. And while that might seem at first like a legitimate observation, I think if we just think of our own family situations, we come from good families, I know most of us, but we also have families with issues. And many of us have seen it happen that sometimes siblings from one generation may have serious difficulties, be estranged for years or decades. They might themselves come together and reconcile. Their own children may see more in the offense than they themselves saw. And so it's not that strange that generations today are actually still grappling with injustices from decades and centuries ago. That's not really remarkable. It's human nature. And none of us should be ashamed of that reality or that experience, that we should feel, even as it were, in our DNA, pain and problems from those who went before us. And we should also be very attentive to the concrete ways in which we can respond to that, making up, for instance, as much as we can for the loss of life and property, which is quite significant. What sort of ravishing effect has happened to so many of the enslaved on this soil to disunify man's natural connection with the land, which should normally, in the normal course of events, make us fruitful and happy, and then that was destroyed when so many were forced to labor without recompense. And then, even after the Emancipation Proclamation, when, due to sharecropping, more or less the same situation endured, there are so many measurable injustices which we can recount. And Dr. King was aware of them, and so he was active. The foundation, though, was ever the gospel of Christ. Years before he was assassinated in 1968, he spent a good portion of time as pastor of a church in Montgomery. And as a Baptist minister, he preached on a regular basis. And two sermons in particular from 1957, I think, are highlight sermons wherein we can see how much of this message of the gospel of Christ, who loves us with a transforming love, who gives his own death and life to reclaim us. Two of these sermons show this in a special way. One was from the springtime in April 7th, and the other in November, in the fall, November 17th. And in these two sermons, Dr. King speaks very, very beautifully about the power and the necessity to forgive our enemies. And he also speaks about the beloved community, a community which is loved. And he references, among other motives to forgive, that we are to see in every single man the imago Dei, to quote him, the image of God. And we are to see in every community the image of God. This is the image of God, to be in community. Our God is Trinity. He is a family. He is Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And so, when we think about this gift of the legacy of Dr. King, I'm so glad, Greg, that you asked me to consider this teaching about the beloved community. Because reflecting upon it, it occurred to me that it really is the beginning and the end of his life's work. It is the beginning and the end of that sacrifice of his own life, which pleased God, continues to be for us inspiration and hope. Now, each of us here has our own particular experience of being in a family or being in groups, whether that's like a choir or a parish, maybe a team for sports or a team for work. Those experiences very often are so beautiful. Thanks be to God. Those experiences nourish us. Those experiences make us better and happier. It's also the case that since we are here experiencing community on earth in the midst of brokenness and sin, we have been wounded in various communities. We have been hurt in different interconnections with others. We have in the gospel a solution and a remedy. We have in the gospel God himself, who came among us not to spare us from suffering, but rather to take the power that suffering had to destroy us. He took that away. And now, because of, again, his name and his blood, those things which we suffer, the greatest of injustices, are now united and can be united to his own suffering. And they can now have in him infinite value in the eyes of Almighty God. Now that is inspiration for us not to ignore the suffering. We still are to actively engage in fighting any sort of injustice or lack of charity we see in ourselves or in others. But as we do it, even when it seems that we are facing insurmountable obstacles, whatever they might be, and in whatever ambit, like the political realm or the academic realm, the church realm, whatever the difficulties, we know that we have received in Christ everything that we need and more. And knowing that, we are inspired to continue to fight and to struggle within our communities, but understanding that we do it so very often, one by one. We don't have usually the same platforms that Dr. King had to speak to thousands at one time. But because of the power of Christ, every time we love within the community which is ours, that could just be the two people at breakfast with us, or the handful of people who come together to pray the rosary on First Saturday. It could be the very difficult people with whom we work. When we make small acts of love in union with Christ, then we are creating and sustaining beloved community. We are extending the life of the Trinity itself to this fallen world. And so we have this opportunity to thank God today, here gathered in this space, to ask that he will continue to use us as instruments to build a beloved community after the manner of Dr. King, indeed, but really after the manner of his own work, after the manner in which Christ himself built up community by calling what sort of people, what sort of men were those first apostles? They were not perfect in the least. They had major issues with God and among themselves. If we listen to the Gospels, the apostles did not always get along, and sometimes for good reason. Yet, with their eyes fixed on Jesus and with his grace, we now celebrate so very many of them reigning in heaven. Now, moving towards the end of this, thank you for staying with me, by the way. There's another observation, critique even, levied not so much from outside the black community in the United States, but sometimes from some of the brightest minds in our own community against the work of Dr. King, and that is that it was too Christian, precisely because there was this emphasis on forgiveness. And sometimes as Christians, as believers, we can react very quickly and give a response. That's understandable, but I think it's sometimes good to listen to objections from intelligent people who have them when it comes to the gospel. Because often enough, when we look at the gospel, Christ himself was very patient with those who had questions. Well, the line of thought, to be very simple about it, is that by forgiving too much, by being too ready to pardon, we simply have taken on the role of enablers. We should resist oppression and defend the oppressed. And if we forgive too much, we either run the risk or actually leave things in this situation that those who are oppressed continue to be oppressed and are simply focused on glory in heaven after we die. How convenient. Empirically, that is a very understandable objection. If we just look at the situation as it meets the eye, we can understand how some could bring this point up emphatically. But we still have a response, because in point of fact, the gospel tells us, and this is something I feel that I have learned by experience in 42 years of life, the act of forgiveness itself affects heaven on earth. When we forgive, when we try to put into practice what Dr. King called the glorious commandment to forgive the enemy, then actually what happens is we affect heaven within our souls. In a few minutes, with the words of some priests, Christ will become present sacramentally on the altar because of a simple gesture with simple elements. Heaven will come down to earth. But each and every one of us as individuals, and then we as communities, also have the power to bring heaven to earth by forgiveness. And this is, again, the foundation and the end of the legacy of Dr. King. I propose to you, to forgive does not mean to excuse wrongdoing in the sense of enabling. To forgive means that we do not absorb into our own souls, which are precious and priceless, that destructive bitterness which wrought so much evil in the lives of so many of our ancestors. If it destroyed the earthly lives of so many, that sort of hatred and disregard for the image and likeness of God, how attentive must we be today to not let it destroy our own souls? One of the best ways in which anyone or any people can remember anything important is through song. And I was not able to hear the whole presentation yesterday via Zoom because, you know, it was raining and I had several masses at a couple different churches because it's MLK weekend, actually, in a great part. But I did notice that there was a little music in the presentation. And growing up, as I did in New Orleans with Catholic schools, and by the way, you know, I grew up in the 80s and 90s, okay? So by that point in history, none of the schools in New Orleans were segregated by law. But from the time I was 2 years old through my graduating year of high school, I went to Catholic school the whole time. Only 3 of those years were at what I would call mixed schools ethnically. The other years were in de facto segregated schools for Black Americans. Because again, the problems of the past are not that very past. They're not that far away. Well, anyway, one of the things that we really learn in these environments, which are ours, so Christian and Catholic and Black, is the importance of music. And there are any number of songs that might help us to remember the power of being in a beloved community, but also the importance of welcoming others into that beloved community. I think one in particular speaks to me. It's actually been on my heart and on my YouTube cycle for years. And it's the song, Come Ye Disconsolate, which was composed by an Irish Catholic man, actually. And my favorite version is the version by Donny Hathaway and Roberta Flack. But you can look for the lyrics, because I'm not going to sing the whole song anyway, only one stanza. If you know it, I encourage you to sing along with me. But that, of course, is risky because, you know, New Orleans people tend to make up melodies mid-song. That happens. It's been known to happen. But if we would just, again, listen and think about this, that this is our vocation to say to everyone the words of the song, come ye disconsolate, because everyone is suffering in some way. Everyone is suffering in some way, and everybody needs Jesus. And so whenever we encounter anyone whomsoever, if we would say with words, but most of all with our lifestyle and action, come ye disconsolate, where ye languish, come to the mercy seat, fervently kneel, here bring your wounded heart, here tell your anguish. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. And know that heaven is not only hereafter. Heaven for the heart that forgives is here and now. Amen.
Amen.
As brothers and sisters in faith, we present our prayers and petitions to our generous God.
That our Holy Father, our Archbishop, our auxiliary bishops, and all who are entrusted with teaching God's word may be blessed with wisdom and courage. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the leaders of the world who have the task of governing may carry out their duties with justice and may maintain peace among nations. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That nations may repent for the sins of neglect of the poor and weak, and may reform their laws to protect every human life. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That Christians may join together across denominational lines to help the hungry and the homeless in the spirit of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who lost their lives to COVID-19 and knights and ladies who have died may enjoy the peace of God's kingdom, and those who grieve them may be comforted. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, send your Spirit upon us and strengthen our faith. As you answer our prayers, grant that we may grow in your grace. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. We are always grateful for your generosity to our Cathedral of Our Lady of the Angels. Please take a few moments to prayerfully consider your offertory gift to God in thanksgiving for the many blessings you have received. I now invite the ushers to pass the basket to receive your gifts, and thank you for your generosity.
Martin Luther King.
pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and for the good of all his holy church.
May the saving sacrifice of your Son, the King of Peace, offer under sacramental signs that signify peace and unity, strengthen, we pray, O Lord, concord among all your children. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is the right and just, our dear and our salvation, always and everywhere. To give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him, you have been pleased to renew all things, giving us all a share in his fullness. For though he was in the form of God, he emptied himself, and by the blood of his cross brought peace to all creation. Therefore he has been exalted above all things, and to all who obey him has become the source of eternal salvation. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy,
you are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give light to all things and made them holy. And you never cease to gather people to yourself, so from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said a blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Giving you thanks, he said a blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wonder resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim, by whose aid you will to reconcile us to yourself, and that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ.
May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, our spouse, and with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Jose, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom we have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world.
To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give a kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestowed on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Now let us share with each other a sign of Christ's peace.
The peace of Christ be with you.
Holy Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I'm not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be
with the word.
shall not be in vain. Then my living shall
Thank you.
Let us pray. Bestow on us, we pray, O Lord, the spirit of charity, that sustained by the body and blood of your only begotten Son, we may be effective in nurturing among all the peace that he has left us, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
At this time, the administration of oath of offices for those new officers in the ladies and night divisions. Please, gracious lady, Karen Penson, and past Western State District Deputy, Sir Knight Greg Warner, will administer the oath.
Good afternoon. At this time, I like all ladies, knights, junior daughters, junior knights, who have been elected for an office in your court or council, CCC, assembly, or chapter, to please come forward to take the oath of office.
With full realization of your responsibilities of your office, are you willing and ready to assume office? Please raise your right hand. Repeat after me. I state your name. In the presence of those assembled here today, do pledge myself to fulfill faithfully the duties of the office of which I have been elected. I will obey the Constitution and the bylaws of our order, national, district, and local. I will ever work for harmony in this organization, both by good example and diligent work. At the expiration of my office, I will deliver to my successor all goods, properties, and monies in my possession belonging to the order. I hereby declare you duly installed officers of the office of which you have been elected to fulfill your term of office and serve until your successor has been duly elected and installed. May your term of office of each of you be a time of joy and faithful work. Thank you. Congratulations.
Please wait. The Archbishop is going to give a blessing.
It is my honor to bless the newly elected officers. Therefore, let us pray. Almighty God, we give you thanks for the many and varied ways you built up your church. Bless these officers in their respective councils, courts, assemblies, and chapters. Grant that through their vision and direction, they may be of service to their brothers and sisters and bring honor and glory to your name. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Congratulations to you all.
Thank you, Archbishop Gomez. For those of you who may not know, the Archbishop is a fourth degree Knight of Peter Claver. So it's most fitting that he would give you that blessing as the shepherd of this church and also a member of our order. Most Reverend Jose Gomez, I want to personally thank you for being not only being here and being our celebrant, for all the support that you've been giving us as a community, support you've been giving us, our order, the Knights of Peter Claver. We thank you very much for that. Thank you. It is also good to see Bishop Dave here. Bishop Dave has walked with us for a long time at St. Francis Cabrini and St. Michael. And we thank you for your presence. We thank also the Concelebrating priests. It is always wonderful to see so many of you here helping us as we celebrate the life and the contributions that Dr. King has made to our community and to us as a people. Thank you for being here with us. And Father Clark, I think that you really hit it on the head as you delivered your homily around the beloved, beloved community. It was a perfect way, I think, to end this weekend. We started off at our breakfast talking about the beloved community and the Drum Major Award, how all of that kind of came together. And then yesterday, we again addressed the whole beloved community in a workshop where we tried to look into the 21st century and see what differences and how close we are to that dream. And that was a wonderful session. And if I can take some liberty now, I'd like to thank Professor Michael Howard, who's here from Washington, D.C., celebrating this weekend and was a member of our panel at LMU. He and his wife are here, Charlene's here, celebrating Mass. So we appreciate you coming, and sorry we couldn't give you more sunshine. But come back again, and next time we'll make sure we got sunshine. Thank you so much. I also want to thank all those officers of the Knights of Peter Claver, the Supreme Lady Michaela LeBlanc, and please let's keep her in prayer as she recovers from that awful fall she had. And I didn't realize how bad it was until Audrey told me that she had to have an artificial elbow. I mean, that I never heard of that. But our prayers go with her, and we ask all of you to pray for our Supreme Lady. It is wonderful, as always, to see our very faithful Supreme Controller, gracious Lady Friends, Wills Aubrey. Good seeing you. Thank you for being here. And we mentioned gracious Lady Karen Benson, who's the district deputy, and our most recent past district deputy, Sir Knight Greg Warner. I want to recognize the African-American Catholic Center of Evangelization Mass Choir, directed by Oscar Pratt. The choir's just coming out of hiatus. They've been away because of COVID. But Oscar's got them back, and I think the voices are in great shape. Please give them a hand of applause. Thank you all for coming. We'd like to invite you back on February the 18th here at the Cathedral. We will be celebrating our Black History Mass, and we're going to continue with this beloved community, but we're going to talk about walking together. Black people, all people, walking together. And maybe we can make that dream actually a reality in our own lives. Because it's left up to us individually to make the dream come true. Dr. King died to give us the opportunity to be able to do that. So now it's our duty to work on that part of getting the dream in our lives, in our community, in our church. I think the Archdiocese and Archbishop Gomez have gone a long way in developing a program that was introduced to you this weekend at our breakfast and then again in our workshop. I think that all we need to do now is to do our part. I want to thank the cathedral staff. And Monsignor, thank you for your hospitality. You're always so gracious to us. Thank you. And I want to especially thank Edward. He's always here. With him and Father Ray, I don't know what I do. I mean, they keep me walking in a straight line. Sometimes it's difficult because the things we like to do that really is not proper. And they gently will encourage me to go. So thank you for your support as well. For those of you who've been here before, you know this is a holiday. And the prices in the parking structure are sky high. So the normal price for parking here is $10. There will be a validation for you as you leave the cathedral at the door to reduce that holiday fee down to $10. So please stop and get your validation. If not, when you get to go out and you go to that meter, you're going to be surprised at what it's going to cost you. Thank you so much for being here, and may God bless you. God bless the Knights of Peter Claver. God bless the African American Center and all people who are serving God. Thank you.
Please stand for the final blessing. It's always a special joy, this celebration of this Mass for Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So it is, and today, especially reflecting on the beloved community, I think that helps all of us to continue reflecting on the beautiful reality of God's love for us and how He's asking us to love one another. So let us continue to think about it and make it a reality in our lives, in our families, and in our church and in our society. The Lord be with you.
Bow down for the blessing.
May Almighty God bless you in His kindness and pour out saving wisdom upon you.
Amen.
May He nourish you always with the teachings of the faith and make you persevere in holy deeds.
Amen.
May He turn your steps toward Himself and show you the path of charity and peace.
Amen.
And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Amen. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Lift every voice.
My joy, till victory is won.
King Day.